Hi everyone, welcome to this YouTube video where we are going to talk about collecting mouse responses and using regions of interest in Open Sesame. So about regions of interest, imagine the following task where you ask your participants which of the following pictures contains a bunny. So you show participants a display with a fixation dot and a target stimulus containing a bunny and a distractor stimulus containing a cat. And you ask participants to respond by using the mouse. And more precisely, you ask them to click on the image which they think contains a bunny. So as a researcher, you are obviously most interested in mouse clicks on the target or on the distractor. And you are not very interested in mouse clicks on an empty part of the display, so in the gray area here. In fact, you might even want to ignore those mouse clicks. You want to force participants to click on a relevant part of the display. And these relevant parts of the display are called regions of interest. In Open Sesame, you can implement regions of interest by making use of the fact that you can give elements in your sketchpad a name, and by making use of the fact that a mouse response item automatically creates a variable called cursor ROI, where ROI obviously stands for region of interest. So imagine that I have the following experimental structure. I have an experimental loop, a block loop, and a trial sequence, so a typical template. And in the block loop, I prepared two trials. I defined the target, which is a PNG file containing a picture of a bunny, and I defined a distractor, which is a PNG file containing a picture of a cat. And I added these PNG files to the file pool of my experiment, and I'm going to show the stimuli by using a sketchpad item that I called target display, and this item has a central fixation point and the question marks show the placeholders of the two stimuli. So when I'm looking at the experimental script, you will see that I used the square bracket syntax to draw the target at an x position of -250, so at the left part of the screen, and I'm drawing the distractor at an x position of 250, positive, so at the right side of the screen. And then after showing these stimuli, I'm going to collect a mouse response or mouse click by using a mouse response item. And then at the end of the trial, I'm going to log everything to my output file by using a logger item. So what happens if I run this experiment? I see the target and the distractor, and Open Sesame waits for mouse click. So if I click on the target, the experiment continues. Now the second trial is shown, and Open Sesame is waiting for another mouse click. But as you will see, the way I implemented it now, I am also allowed to click at an empty space of the display. And then the experiment will still continue, like this. So this is a start, but it's not completely what we want yet. To use regions of interest, I'm going to use the variable that I mentioned before, that is called cursor ROI. So I'm going to click on the variable inspector and I type it in, cursor ROI, and you see that the variable already exists. It's automatically created by the mouse response item. However, the value of this variable is still undefined, and that is because the variable cursor ROI will only get a value if the mouse response item is linked to a sketchpad item. So that's the first thing that I'm going to do. Here we see linked sketchpad, no item selected. I click on it. So now I'm going to select the sketchpad to which this mouse response should be linked. And in my example, I only have one sketchpad, the target display, so I'm going to click on this one. Now the mouse response is linked to the previous target display. So what happens with our variable cursor ROI now? If we run the experiment again, first I'm going to click on an empty space, and we see that cursor ROI is now no longer undefined, but actually the value is empty, it's an empty string. And if I click on the target now, we will see that cursor ROI is not undefined anymore and it has a value, namely stim1. While I was test running the experiment, as you remember, for the second trial I clicked on the target, and apparently this target is called stim1 by default. So the distractor, which is actually the second element that we draw on the sketchpad, will get the default name stim2. So you see that we are getting somewhere. The cursor ROI variable is more informative than it was before, but it's not really informative yet, because stim1 and stim2 doesn't mean too much to us. To give cursor ROI an informative value, we can give our elements on the sketchpad a name. So I'm first going to click on the placeholder for the target element, which was always on the left, as you remember. And then in the box name, instead of auto, I'm going to call this element the target. Then I click on the second placeholder, the distractor on the right, and I'm going to name this element distractor. So you'll probably understand the reasoning. If I'm going to do another test run and I click on the target, the value of cursor ROI should now be target. And if I click on the distractor, it should be distractor. So I click on the distractor, the target, and indeed cursor ROI now has the value target. But as you will see, I'm also still allowed to click on an empty space of the display. If I click here, the experiment continues and cursor ROI no longer has a value. So how can we prevent this from happening? How can we make sure that mouse responses are only logged when the participant actually clicked on a relevant part of the screen and not somewhere in an empty space? A very convenient item to use here is the repeat cycle item. And just to warn you, the procedure that I'm going to show right now is not exactly correct, but I'm still going to show it to you so that you can follow the logic of the procedure that is actually correct. Imagine that I'm going to drag a repeat cycle item to the end of my trial sequence. You can see in the description that this repeat cycle element repeats a cycle from a loop if a certain criterion is met, which sounds exactly like what we want, because we want to repeat a given cycle as long as cursor ROI is equal to this empty string that we saw when I clicked on the gray area, which is defined by simply opening and closing a string with nothing in between. What happens if I run this experiment? Trial 1 is shown, and I will click on the gray area, so not on one of the stimuli, and we see that Open Sesame nevertheless goes to trial 2. Now I'm going to be a good participant. I will click on the target, and you will see that trial 1 is now repeated, because my previous behavior on trial 1 was that I clicked on the gray area, so cursor ROI had this empty string, and therefore it is repeated now, until I click on a region of interest, the target, and then Open Sesame finishes successfully. So you will see that the repeat cycle item did its job. It remembered that my behavior on trial 1 was not what we want, and therefore at the end of the block loop it repeated trial 1 until I showed the desired behavior. But this is not actually what I had in mind. What I want to do is that target 1 stays on screen until I click on one of the relevant items. In other words, I want trial 1 to be repeated immediately if I did not click on a region of interest, and not only at the very end of my block loop. To achieve that, I'm going to wrap an additional loop sequence structure around part of my trial sequence. So I grab an additional loop item, I drop it onto the trial sequence, and then on top of this new loop item, I drop a sequence item. And then I'm going to start by giving my new items a meaningful name. I'm calling the loop click loop, and I'm going to call the new sequence click sequence. And then I will drag the target display, the mouse response item, and the repeat cycle item to this click sequence. The logger can stay where it is, because actually I only want to log responses that meet our criteria. I only want to log mouse clicks where the participant clicked on the target or the distractor. So what happens now if I run my experiment? I'm going to click in the gray area. I'm clicking on the empty space all the time now, and I see that trial 1 is repeated and repeated and repeated until I click on one of the stimuli, which I'm going to do now. I will click on the distractor, and then Open Sesame goes to trial 2. Again, I'm clicking in the gray area now. Open Sesame keeps repeating this trial until I click, for example, on the target. Then you see that Open Sesame finished successfully. So we achieved our goal. We made sure that Open Sesame only accepts or logs mouse clicks on regions of interest. As a little bonus, I'm also going to show you how we can determine whether the response of the participant was correct or not. To do that, I'm going to grab a Python inline script item and I drag it onto the mouse response so that it appears right after it. Because of course we can only evaluate a response after the response was given. I'm going to give my item a meaningful name. I'll call it evaluate response. And I'm going to type my script in the run tab of this item. And the logic is very simple. You will agree that if the variable cursor ROI is equal to target, then it means that the participant responded correctly. So the variable correct gets the value 1. If participants did not click on the target, the variable correct gets the value 0. And you see that I'm using the var dot notation here, which is the Python inline equivalent of the square bracket syntax. All the experimental variables throughout our experiment are stored in the var object. So the correct notation to use variables preceded by var dot. Okay, so how about this variable correct? It's still undefined now, but what if I'm going to do a test run? Here I will respond correctly. I will click on the bunny. And we see that correct now gets the value 1. And if I click on the distractor, we see that correct has the value. Okay, so far about collecting mouse responses and using regions of interest in Open Sesame. In the next video, I'm going to show you how we can achieve the same behavior when you want to run your study online by using the OSWeb extension. If using OSWeb, things are a little bit more complicated, but still doable. So I see you then for the next video.